Well, it's time once again to take a look back at an old classic episode of Doctor Who. Our adventure, rather. There's four episodes in the one I'm about to talk about. But the last time I did one, we said goodbye to William Hartnell's Doctor in the 10th Planet. And which also not only introduced the new Doctor, but introduced the Cybermen, who will appear several times throughout the second Doctor's adventures. So, the immediate adventure was Power of the Daleks, which I don't own, but I did see it in its animated form, because all of that's gone. There were telesnaps, as they call them, these stills that they shot. Not all the episodes had those, but I imagine that aided the animation process quite a bit to get it as close as they could. But the animation, as will be explored here as well, does have its weaknesses. But in a lot of ways, it's the only way to do this. So I prefer the ones where there's at least some of the episodes left, and it's cool to compare between the two, and you get a very good idea of what it must have looked like in the original episode. So, jumping along here, Patrick Troughton episode that I have is the Moon Base, which is the second appearance of the Cybermen. Now, since then, they, of course, with Power of the Daleks, the Highlanders, which introduced Jamie McCrimmon, who probably, of all the male companions, is probably the most significant one, who held quite a prominent position in the Second Doctor's adventures, on par with female companions. And that never really happened again after that. Most of the time, it's the female companions are the main companion for Doctor Who. But so Jamie was there. I think there were attempts at replicating that later. Like, I think Adric was supposed to be that, but it never really happened. But anyway, there you go. Jamie's already a member of the crew at this point. And they had the Underwater Menace, and then they arrive on the Moon Base. Ben and Polly are still there, so of course, when they see the Cybermen, they do realize it's the Cybermen, and actually they just flat out recognize them, which actually they shouldn't, because they look a lot different. Now, this is the second version of them, so the Cybermen tend to upgrade as they go along, and this one, if you can call it that, you know, it's funny, my favorite versions of the Cybermen as they stand now is the Peter Davison era version of them, and then the original, the Mondas version, since Peter Capaldi pushed to have them in his final episode. And they just look so spooky, and it was almost like zombies and stuff. And that's one of the thing about the face of the Cybermen, is that it's all the humanity's been removed, and it's this kind of haunting look to it. If you know what you're doing and can make it right with lighting and whatnot, it really has a creepy effect to it. They don't always achieve it, but it is there. So, yes, the Cybermen are now in another nefarious plot to destroy life on Earth. Not out of something petty like revenge. They don't even understand revenge. No, they just want to eliminate any possible threat. So here they are on the, they somehow survived the destruction of Mondas, and so we'll later learn that they moved to the planet Telos, but that's another story. And so the Doctor and his companions arrive on the moon. Now, some of these episodes, everything is a cliffhanger, even when the adventure is over. Like in most Doctor Who, once the adventure is over, they tell a little joke or something, and then the Doctor and the companion head off into the TARDIS and disappears, and that's it. Each episode carries on from the previous one. So there was some sort of cliffhanger, and they're all kind of, the TARDIS is out of control, and then, it stabilizes and they land on the moon, and the Doctor just sort of pretends like, I meant for it to do that, you know. So they put on their spacesuits and head out onto the moon, and lo and behold, there's a moon base there. And what's it doing? Well, they have a device called the Gravitron, and they use that to control the weather on the Earth, so you can avoid all those nasty storms like hurricanes and whatnot. And well, guess what? The Cybermen want to infiltrate that base and use that machine to destroy life on Earth. So there you go. And of course, the Doctor and his companions just stumble along. And at first, like all of these space stations and bases in trouble, at first, like, hey, who are you? And then, whatever. So, of course, the Doctor shows up and they've got a problem. Several members of their crew get sick. And they send them to the sick bay or the infirmary, and they've got these weird markings on them. And at first I thought, oh, they're already introducing the Cybermat, which would do similar things like that. But no, what the Cybermen did was they put in some sort of, I don't know, viral thing or what have you in the sugar. So if you had sugar with your coffee, then you got sick, and this allowed the Cybermen to take you over and turn you into their puppet. And that's what they did. Meanwhile, where were the Cybermen hiding? There's only like two rooms in this set. It's not a bad set. I mean, it's of course, it's all black and white and everything. But from what they had, yeah, it's not too bad, not too shabby. And you got the nice little scene in the background of the moonscape and all that. But it turns out they tunneled underground and drilled a hole through their storeroom and just snuck in, and nobody noticed. And then the Doctor says, wait a minute, you've searched this place every nook and cranny, huh? Oh, yeah, yeah. It's like, where could they be hiding? And then it turns out the Cyberman was just laying there under a blanket in the infirmary. And he rips off his blanket and just, ha-ha! And actually kind of almost knocks over one of the props there. And so there you go. Oh, no, we got Cybermen. They just never noticed his silver-painted work boots. And that's what it is. Yeah, the costume, okay, it's an upgrade from the previous one, even though I said I'm partial to that one. But it's basically just a silver jumpsuit and work boots painted silver. And then they've got these new helmets. But it's coming back to the original one, which was obviously a cloth outfit and everything. But it's like, well, there's still some flesh and bone and involved in their bodies. They're just replacing parts. So as they go, before they become completely mechanical, through their upgrades over the years, it's not crazy to think that they would just have these suits and would have boots and gloves and whatnot, where somewhere along you probably wouldn't want to see them naked, because it's probably a lot missing. Might look pretty gory under there, but it's not a total absurdity in the sense that, oh, well, it was a cheap old show and they didn't have the money and the technology and whatnot. But it still works in that element that, yeah, but it's just a suit covering up the surgical damage they've done to themselves in their insane desire to perfect their lives or what have you, and seek a sort of immortality through being these cybernetic people. So anyway, the plot goes through. All in all, it's not all that great of an episode, and there's some kind of things where the base is just really stupid. What are you going to do? And the Cyberman even tells him, you're really stupid. So what are you going to do? But eventually, of course, the Doctor figures out, hey, we can use the Gravitron as a weapon and save the day. But not before they lost a whole spaceship full of guys flying into the sun. But hey, what are you going to do? Now, the animation is superior in how the Cybermen look. But that's about it. They do recapture the set very well. And I'm assuming there were telesnaps for this one, too. So they probably were able to get it pretty accurate. But plus, it's even better because there's two episodes missing out of a four-part serial here. And so you can compare and contrast between the two. But also, since it's all one set soundstage shot of a story, there's not a lot for them to miss here. So the animation's okay in some elements, but it suffers from the same problem that I noticed in The Power of the Daleks, is that it doesn't quite translate. There's quite a few scenes where obviously body language and whatnot was going on in the original, and the cartoon just cannot quite capture that. So it's kind of odd where they just sort of stand around and their eyes move back and forth and stuff like that. But It's it, it you know you just got to take it. I am going to do one where there was no animation and an episode's missing, and it is just the telly snaps with some explanation in the audio. But obviously the animation is better than that, in that you don't have to read the episode. But anyway. Another aspect of this, I've seen a lot of different Doctor Who videos when they wanted to look back at the old shows and say that, well, it was a very misogynist show and all this sort of thing. And they'll show this clip where the Doctor tells Polly to go make coffee since they're on her way. But they fail to remember that she's the one who comes up with a way to fight back against the Cybermen. She begins to think that, hey, we could dissolve the plastics in their breathing apparatus with some acetone and whatever other solvents that they find in the, you know, the storeroom there, and they make a mixture of it, and they got these spray bottles, and sure enough it works, and they're able to attack. And boy, I tell you, there's some really gruesome scenes in a way. I mean, it's silly, of course, but I mean, they show they're able to kill one of the Cybermen that's chasing a guy in space or on the lunar surface, and Ben tosses a bottle full of this solvent, and it hits him, and it pours into the Cyberman's breathing apparatus, and then as he's dying, it infiltrates his system, and it comes out of his mouth. It's like, geez, it's really gruesome. I don't know. I wondered if the original did that. I don't know, but so yeah, that's it. But again, Polly's the one who decides this on her own, and then she, you know, gets Ben to help her, and they, you know, work it out. So, boy, it's funny how people forget that part, huh? Yeah, won't give Doctor Who credit for that, will you? No. So there's that. But yes, the animation suffers from being unable to translate completely, and also it's not the best animation. But in comparison to the original episode scenes you get, the Cybermen look very impressive in the cartoon. But other than that, this is kind of a strong 3-star. And when you're a Doctor Who fan, you like it. And, you know, the elements of it. And it's kind of like when I first saw some of these, it was like a discovery, because I grew up on, you know, Tom Baker and Pertwee and Peter Davison and all that. And so it's always fun like that. So I give it 4 stars. But an interesting look into that, and also developing ideas about the Cybermen as they progress, and also this idea that it's a better idea of splashing them with a solvent that damages their breathing apparatus. Later on, they use gold dust. It seems like, wouldn't any dust do? But this one, I thought, man, that's a little better. Another interesting thing, there's a brief scene where the Cybermen seem to recognize the Doctor, which is odd, considering that if any of those were the remnants of the original, or if they had the records of their Mondas destruction adventure, he doesn't look anything like the Doctor did back then. So, I don't know. I guess it doesn't really matter. So there you go, Doctor Who and the Moon Base. The first time I knew of this adventure was, it was one of the first Doctor Who novels that I had read, because that was the only way I was going to get the adventure. And boy, a lot of those novels really make it sound incredible. But that's the book, and when the theater's your mind, it's always better. So there you go, Doctor Who and the Moon Base, the first adventure that I'm looking back at in this little series of classic Doctor Who videos I'll be doing for the second Doctor. And I don't have the Macro Terra. Now, this is another one where they save the day at the moon base. They hop on the TARDIS and take off. And then, oh, no, there's something wrong. And then there's this giant claw. And that was the Macro Terra, which they've animated. And I don't have it. And I have not seen it. So I don't think I'll be doing that one. But I do have another one. So thank you for watching and listening. Please like and subscribe, and if you have subscribed, thank you very much. I do appreciate it. And hey, while you're here, why not check out that link description below? That'll take you to my mini stores that have plenty of goodies for you. Yeah, you.